everyone, and welcome to the Resleevables, the dark edition. I'm your host, Cedric Phillips, at Cedric A. Phillips on all the things, and I am joined by apparently a big fan of the dark, Patrick Sullivan, at Basic Mountain on Twitter. Patrick, I didn't know this about you, but apparently you love this set.
I adore this set. Part of it is one of the first pieces of Magic promotional material that I ever ran into. There's a card shop that was about a 20-minute bike ride from my house.
Okay.
And over the summer, I got to an age where my parents were like, okay, yeah, you can bike over there if you want to.
Whoa, they're letting you go solo?
Yeah, letting me go solo. Okay. It involved a little bit of kind of highway driving, so it was a big step up.
Okay.
Not like the freeway, but, you know, like a busy road in the town.
Gotcha.
So the store, at this point, I was playing Magic for a little while, but my familiarity was almost exclusively with Revised.
Okay.
That was the product that was most easily available. I know that it came out before some of the sets that we reviewed, but in terms of it just being generally available and having a large print run, Revised was the set that you could get. So getting yourself acclimated with the older sets, again, pre-internet, was a cool part of the early player experience. And my store had a poster hung up that was basically a print sheet of the entire set of the dark.
Okay.
And I remember going over the store multiple times a week and just staring at that thing. Just looking at Kolgal and being like, that's the coolest thing I've ever seen.
Well, it is a very, very cool looking card.
So I still have a lot of sentimentality for it. And in spite of the fact that the set is small, not particularly powerful, and nothing really in terms of new mechanics, I think there are some cool design sensibilities going on here and individual cards that we'll get to as the show goes on. But a lot of my attachment simply has to do with looking at that poster at Cards and Comics multiple times a week and just wondering how I could get my hands on these cards.
Was that the name of your store, Cards and Comics?
It was one of a few that were in the town.
Okay.
The one that was there the longest was a store called Play Ball.
Okay.
Unfortunately, this store turned out to be an organized crime front. And so they did have very good prize support for their local tournaments.
Actually, no. Yeah. Given what they turned up being, that's a good name for the store.
Yeah, Play Ball was great.
You will play ball.
But Cards and Comics was open under different ownership and in different iterations in my town throughout the mid to late 90s. And eventually the only game in town opened up late 90s, and the rest is history.
Okay, well, if you are with us for our Legends episode, as Patrick mentioned many times during that episode, there's just a lot of cards in there. So that episode is very long. As you will find here with the dark, this episode is significantly shorter because there's not a lot of cards. There's not like new mechanics there's some stuff going on, but not a lot of stuff going on.
Mm-hmm. You like lands that don't make mana? We got a load of those.
Yes, we do. So as always, we're going to kick off this episode of the Resleevables with the facts of the dark. All right, everybody, it is now time for the facts of the dark here on the Resleevables. Some interesting little notes here. I don't have a ton of facts here, but we are going to kick things off with the easiest one, which is the dark is the fourth Magic the Gathering expansion. It includes a goblin tribal theme, powerful abilities with intense colored mana and upkeep cost, and the return, for better or worse, of poison counters. Now, I already know that my partner here knows the answer to these questions, but I'm going to ask him anyway. Introduced, did the dark, the first multicolored non-creature card, which is?
Dark Heart of the Woods.
That's correct. It introduced the first common multicolored cards. There are three of them. They are?
Marsh Goblins, Scarwood Goblins, and again, Dark Heart of the Woods.
That is correct. And it introduced, did the dark, the first enemy pair multicolored card, which again is?
Dark Heart of the Woods.
Yes. There you go. One could argue this set's MVP.
We'll get into it a little bit later, but this, along with Elves of Deep Shadow, there's some really incredible early design stuff going on with these two cards in particular.
The Dark's lands have a unique dark grayish purplish colored text box, which was reprinted on the Chronicles version of Safe Haven. So when we get to Chronicles, we'll be able to highlight that for you. And the dark was sold in 8-card booster packs, which included 6 commons and 2 uncommons. Let's talk about when the set was released. It was released in August of 1994. The print run was estimated to be 62 million cards. It was available from mid-August 94 through late November 1994. And The Dark was the first set that was released in Italian, which might sound a little strange if you're with us for our Legends episode or our Italian Legends Crack-A-Pack, because that set was technically released before The Dark. However, Italian Legends was actually released after The Dark was released. So chronologically, it goes Legends, The Dark slash Italian The Dark, mm-hmm. and then Italian Legends.
Yeah, and the Italian Legend stuff is basically, you know, a second print run, effectively. Yeah. These were much more concurrent.
The Dark contains 121 cards, and it contains 119 unique cards. 41 commons, 1 at C1, 40 at C3, and then there's 78 uncommons, 35 at U1 and 43 at U2. For those of you print run fans out there, the C1 and U2 cards are together considered the uncommons of the set, and the U1 cards, of which there are 35, are considered the rares.
So, to give you a little bit more explanation of how this early print run stuff happens, U2 in this case means two copies of this card appear on the uncommon sheet. U1 means one copy of this appears on the uncommon sheet. Now, there are more U2s than U1s, mm-hmm. so that means that the U1s, effectively the rares, are slightly less than two times as rare as the U2s.
Got it. Okay. The Dark set symbol, a layup, super good. Might be the best one in Magic at this point, the Thin Crescent Moon.
It's certainly up there, and I don't know if this one is a layup so much, because there are a lot of different tropes you could go to that would also fit in this world, but I don't think would be nearly as good.
Okay.
You could have, you know, werewolf or vampire fangs. There's a whole bunch of horror iconography that you could lean into.
Okay.
But that crescent moon is just...
it's pretty iconic.
So good.
Oh, yeah.
So good.
The set, let's talk about who it was designed and developed by. It was designed by... I apologize if I get any names wrong here. I do my best. Jesper Mierfors, Steve Bishop, Glenn Elliott, and Beverly Marshall Sailing. It was developed by a team that we have seen do some other development here in Scaff Elias, Jim Lynn, Chris Page, and Dave Petty. That quad was the same team that did Legends, so it looks like internally during that time that Wizards of the Coast has kind of formed a development team, one could argue.
You could still see that this is relatively small because you have one of the artists also working on the initial design team, mm-hmm. and then the same handful of developers doing the final design stuff.
Yeah.
There's a solid roster of, you know, organized who's responsible for this, who's responsible for that. And in contrast to, let's say, Alpha, we're at the point where design and development are a little demarcated. It's not everything going on all at once, but we're still talking about a pretty small organization. And it's part of the reason you hear the same names come up over and over again when we're talking about the early design development of these sets.
And it looks like we're out of the Legends phone call nonsense. Ring, ring, ring. Let's make this card.
Yeah.
Discourse that we talked about.
Let's try to keep it all in house.
Yes.
It's a little bit easier.
might be for the best. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Guess what? That's all I have for facts of the set. That's it.
They just want to make, there's a lot of demand for Magic. Let's make something sweet. Let's make the tone and the vibe of the world different than what we've done before. And here you go.
Yeah. Pretty straightforward and simple, excuse me, which means we're going to take a short break. When we come back, we're going to talk about the flavor and the storyline of The Dark. All right, everybody, we are back to discuss the flavor and the storyline of The Dark. I'm going to use that voice for most of my time saying The Dark.
Yeah, for sure.
I think I'm doing okay there. Anybody needs any voice work, let me know. I don't have a ton here as far as the flavor and the storyline is concerned, but I found some little snippets in my internet sleuthing. The Dark was introduced with a short story describing the ominous and powerful nature of the dark magic from which the set took its name. Now, in the flavor text of the set's cards, another story was told. So gather around while I tell you a very short story. The climax of the Brothers' War was the Silex Blast, which lofted debris into the air, blotting out the sun and creating the Dark, which took place roughly 384 years before the Ice Age fully began on Dominaria. spoiler, we're going to get into Ice Age pretty soon here on the show. Without the sun, the climate begins to cool and an anti-magic religion comes to power, blaming the Silex Blast and its effects on all magic and its users. Persecution of these magic-using wizards led to the creation of the fabled City of Shadows, which is actually a card in this set, in the east, and the Conclave of Mages in the west, where they hid themselves during this time. So, that's story time with me.
Love it.
Thank you.
You could easily imagine naming the set Darkness.
Sure.
Right? What I love about the name The Dark in lieu of Darkness or something else, Darkness, or a similar word, feels like that's describing a state of being.
Sure.
The Dark feels like you're referencing a singular event, which is true in this case.
Yeah, blotting out the sun.
Yeah. So there was a magical event, blotted out of the sun, and that is The Dark. I think, again, we're going to get more into the sort of the names, the flavor, the creative of the set, but just one more 10 out of 10 in a set that has nothing but 10 out of 10s in it.
Okay, so of the sets that we've covered five sets before this. ABU, really no story.
Mm-hmm.
Antiquities.
Brothers War.
Yeah, there's that story. Arabian Nights. Stole a story. Like, stole strong. But like,
was inspired by.
Yes, that's better. Was inspired by a thing. Revised. Nothing. That's just reprints. And mm-hmm. then
Legends.
Legends, which is
not well, really. I would argue that Alpha has the story of here is the world of Dominaria.
Okay.
And we're not gonna tell the story in very much detail, but as I mentioned in that show, you're thumbing through the monster manual, you're thumbing through the Dungeon Master Guide and getting a sense of what the world is and these different areas, but it's not a really prescriptive story. There's no protagonist, it's just here's a world you're observing and then eventually participating in. Legends has more specificity in terms of its characters, and certainly the legends themselves are conveying, like, yeah, there's characters in the world. They're more important than the non-legendary creatures that you come across.
Yep.
But I would still describe it as sort of Dominaria adjacent.
Okay.
In terms of here's a broad world. There's some locations that are hinted at. There's some lands that, you know, say Urborg and Talaria, you're getting a sense that there's a bit a world there,
mm-hmm.
but it's not really telling a story. This is even, I would argue, a greater abstraction than Legends or Alpha. It's pulling back even, or I guess zooming in even further. And this is a very particular interpretation of horror tropes inside this sort of broad world of Dominaria that you have some sense of, but we really haven't told much of a story yet.
I think that this is, as far as the set is concerned, of the six that we've covered, I think this is telling probably the most interesting story so far.
Well, you know, they're executed in different ways, and I would not blame or critique anyone who happened to grab onto one versus the other.
Sure.
But this is, you know, more of all the sets, it's way more vibes than a story.
Yes.
But that's a cool part of the range too.
Yeah.
And this set is, you know, kind of the first time that that's been the execution in Magic's history.
Guess what? That's all we've got for you for flavor and storyline of The Dark. When we do come back, we're moving on to the mechanics of the set. And Patrick already told you, there's not a ton, but we'll do the best we can. See you in a sec. All right, it is time to go over the mechanics from The Dark. I don't have very many for you fine folks that are watching this video on YouTube, but I can tell you that The Dark greatly expanded upon the concept of a tribe, or a specific creature type, which Legends touched on a little bit, kobolds, and we have seen in the early days of Lord of Atlantis and Goblin King being lords for their respective creature types. However, in The Dark, we see six goblins, a card named Goblin Rock Sled. Spoiler, it's not a goblin. Two creatures with abilities that reference goblins, two auras that can give a bonus to goblins, and a sorcery that, unfortunately, destroys all goblins in Tividar's Crusade. Despite this creature-type theme, most of the rest of the set used unusual creature-specific creature types like other early expansions, which means we're going to have to play a name game.
Oh boy.
Are you ready to for me to name the creature type and you name the card?
Yeah.
Okay. The following creature types are introduced in The Dark. Pardon me. The Dark. Bandit.
I don't know.
Scarlet Bandit. You're 0 for 1. Brothers.
Brothers of Fire.
That is correct. Cave People.
Cave People.
That is correct. Exorcist.
Exorcist.
That is correct. Hunter.
Witch Hunter?
That is correct. Miracle Worker.
Is it Miracle Worker?
That is correct. Mob.
Angry Mob.
That is correct. People of the Woods.
People of the Woods.
That is correct. Pikeman.
Pikeman.
That is correct. Preacher.
Preacher.
That is correct. Robbers.
Grave Robbers.
That is correct. Scavenger Folk.
Scavenger Folk.
Yes. Sisters.
Sisters of Flame.
That is correct. Squire.
Squire.
Uh-huh. Tracker.
I don't know.
Tracker.
Okay, great. I assume there would have been some sort of adjective there or a place it's from or a thing that it tracks. No, this is just the tracker.
It's the tracker.
This is John Tracker. Job tracking,
tracking
thing.
Tracking.
Anything you need tracked.
Uncle Istvan.
Uncle Istvan.
Non-legendary creature.
Very weird.
Leeches.
Land leeches?
That is correct. Lurker.
It's a cop out to say lurker, but I don't have a better guess.
That's correct.
It's lurker.
Joe okay. Lurker.
Joe Lurker.
I lurk. Nameless race.
Nameless race.
That's a free one. Whippoorwill.
Whippoorwill.
That's correct. Ball lightning.
Ball lightning.
Eel.
Electric eel.
Shark.
Giant shark.
That is correct. Rock sled.
Goblin rock sled.
That is correct.
This is really bad, by the way. This one was not a goblin.
That's the biggest mistake they may have made in the set, I think. Eater.
Eater of the Dead?
That is correct. Ragman.
Ragman.
That is correct. General.
Goblin General?
Orcus
General.
It is Orc General.
Orc General. Really weird to do an Orc General in a set that's like the preponderance of red cards is goblins.
Yeah, I didn't really.
Because an Orc is just a goblin.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that how that works? Are Orcs goblins?
No, they're just separate, but like
yeah.
In D&D sort of tropes, they are indistinguishable.
Sure.
I guess orcs are usually larger, more muscular, tougher.
Yeah, the orc general looks like a goblin. Whatever.
Whatever.
Nail, yep. N-I-A-L-L-S-I-L-V-A-I-N.
I believe the creature type and the name are the same.
That is correct. Nailey Sullivan. Yep. Sullivan? What? I don't know what I just said. Viper.
Marsh Viper?
That is correct. Banshee.
I don't know.
Banshee.
Come on.
Fallen.
The Fallen.
John Fallen.
Jimmy Fallen.
And Merc Dwellers.
Merc Dwellers?
That is correct. You only got like 3 or 4 wrong. I'm sure there's some dings and some boops in there. A lot of weird creature types here. Even though this set kind of specializes in goblins, mostly. But this is, as the initial note said, it is an attempt at an expansion or conceptually establishing one creature type more than others.
I don't like the execution of creature types very much in the set.
Okay.
Especially coming off of Legends.
Sure.
Like, if you're going to do, you know, this is like sort of a singular creature type, it's unique to this character that already exists with Legends. And it's super confusing and there's a lot of opportunity to convey a lot of flavor about the world if you just have summon human, and that includes Witch Hunter and Brothers of Fire and Sisters of Flame and a myriad of other designs of, yeah, here's how different humans are organized and operating in this world. And the creature types matching the name or being very close to the name really dampens a lot of the flavor in a set that's otherwise very evocative.
Yeah. To me, I was thinking about this yesterday. The Dark, it seems like it's kind of the precursor of Throne of Eldraine. Does that feel correct?
I would point to Innistrad more than Throne in terms of
you're right.
Where you're getting an inspiration from.
Yep, you're right.
Especially because Innistrad is very loud with creature types matter, and by the standards of the era, so is the Dark.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's a little bit of, I mean, certainly the Hans fairy tales does tap into some horror tropes as well.
Yeah.
You know?
No, I think I completely forgot that Innistrad was a thing.
Okay.
And I think you're 100% right. Yeah. Innistrad is a better comp if there were to be one here. Guess what? That's it for mechanics. They didn't introduce anything new.
Well,
really?
Yeah, I mean, it's new in the way the color pie is executed, which we'll get to in a little bit.
Sure.
And there's some new, unique challenges that I think they address in a really brilliant and artistic way. But in terms of, you know, artifacts matter or legendary as a permanent super type or rampage. No, not only is there nothing new here, it barely borrows from anything that came before it.
That was the thing that's really strange to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just all of these creatures and stuff. It's just very generic. Like, this is just what it does.
Yes.
Right. There's nothing. I don't want to say there's nothing unique going on because that's not true. And that's definitely not the right word. But yeah, to what you said, like, you don't find trample on stuff here or really anything.
Yeah. I mean, there's, you know, it depends how you want to define it, but you know, like, Ball Lightning is a mechanically distinct card.
Yeah.
And it's really cool and it's new. And there's a handful of designs in the set that are not as iconic or splashy or have the same tournament resume as Ball Lightning. But that's where you see some of the individual, oh, here's an idea. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But yeah, in terms of new stuff, not only is there not new stuff, there's not even spins on the old stuff.
Yeah.
It's really nuts and bolts.
I am curious if the reason that happened is because they did so much in Legends mm-hmm. that they were just like, okay, let's dial it back a little bit.
I don't know. I vacillate a lot about that. You know, I've worked on card games where, you know, you're making set after set after set after set. And there is sometimes where I have felt like we need some new stuff in here. It's been mm-hmm. kind of the same thing for a while. It's come up with some ideas. And there's also times where I felt we haven't just let the cards speak for themselves in a little while. Can we dial back the amount of new for the sake of being new and just make a fun, evocative set and largely borrow old ideas and with new twists and not necessarily new stuff? And it is possible that the people working on the dark said, like, let's let this breathe a little bit.
Yeah.
You're coming off of Legends, which is really saturated, right?
There's so much in that.
You have a new super type that has its own set of rules associated with it. You have Rampage. You have a set of over 300 cards with a lot of just kind of weird, unique design. Enchant Worlds, it's another new one.
Yep.
So you're coming off of a set that's like so big and so much new stuff that were I working there at the time, I probably would have said, could we back up a little bit?
Sure.
I don't think you're necessarily supposed to put it out of the dark. It would be nice to have one new thing for players to kind of latch on to. But I wouldn't be shocked if this was an intentional, we're kind of overloading things and Legends is particularly overloaded. And let's back up before we just keep running downhill this one way.
Yep. I would agree. That and those are the mechanics of the dark or lack thereof. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, it's one of my favorite parts of the show. We're going to discuss the cycles of the dark. See you in a sec. All right, everybody. We are back here for the cycles of the dark. I really wish we could have recorded this in the dark. No real clean way to do that.
No. Well, it could just be audio and no video.
Ooh, I wonder, you know, our editor John is great. Is there a way like that he could put like a drop shadow? Is definitely not the right term, just some sort of black.
I like the idea of it's pitch black except for our pairs of eyes opening and closing.
Yes. Yeah, is there a way to do that?
No, God, please, no, 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 no.
That's another horror trope, right? Yeah. There's like the bush, there's some wrestling and all you see is the eyeballs.
I love that.
Yeah, it's cool.
I like that. It's kind of scary.
Post, John, get that in post.
There you go.
Should be easy.
Yeah, we know. We edit too. Yeah, should be pretty easy. Cycles from the dark. Let's talk about them. There's not very many here in this set. I got a little loose with my cycles terminology here. So I'm going to start with the color hosers,
mm-hmm.
which kind of sort of exist in this set. There's four white ones. There's two black ones and there's one red one. The white color hosers are Angry Mob, Exorcist, Tividar's Crusade, because it's kind of hosing red and goblins. It's a bit of a stretch. And then Knights of Thorn. Black, we have two. It's Nameless Race and Inquisition. And then red, again, a bit of a stretch here with Goblin Wizard. You and I have talked kind of at length about wizards at the time, their love of hosers. Now, none of these, in my opinion, are. I think your favorite hoser is conversion.
I don't know if it's my favorite one.
Maybe you'd find it to be the most humorous.
What I appreciate about conversion is it is awful, right?
It's, yeah, obviously.
It's tapping into the fact that red can't destroy enchantments and you cannot cast spells for the rest of the game. That's not good. But that is one of the hosers that's like, yeah, you should add a second color to your deck.
Yeah.
And a lot of these are really rough, even if you are playing a two-color deck.
Yeah.
Like someone goes turn one Ritual Gloom, it's not, the experience is not like, oh, well, you know, my green cards are still okay. Sure. It's just like, no, you can't cast, you know, you're pretty much locked. You're not going to be able to cast anything.
Sure.
Conversion has the, well, if you add a second color, one, you can function, and two, you can now find an enchantment removal spell, maybe blow the thing up.
Okay.
So, I mean, I'm not trying to defend it as a design, but
of course.
I have a little bit more appetite for conversion than some of the other ones.
Maybe, just maybe, our friends at Wizards of the Coast decided they still wanted some hoser-esque cards, but they dialed it back a little bit.
It's interesting to me that you point out that white has four.
Yes.
And I've talked a little bit in the show so far about expanding the tonal range of the color pie, and that's a really great example of this.
Okay.
Throughout Magic's first few sets, white is really represented in Dungeons & Dragons terms as lawful good.
Yep.
There are priests and paladins, and you're doing good stuff, and you're protecting things, and, you know, you have Blessing as a card name. They're in Bodyguard.
They're clearly the good guys.
They are clearly, yeah.
Yes.
In a Dungeons & Dragons / medieval sense, they are very much just the generic good people.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you make white tonally make sense in a set that is not about good guys? It's not about daylight. It's not about jousting competitions. That's not the thing that's going on here. And what the set does a very good job of doing, in my opinion, is turning white into more of a lawful evil color.
Mm-hmm.
So you have Preacher and Angry Mob, and even the storyline of sort of the persecution of magic more broadly,
yep,
is sort of a lawful evil execution. And then it makes sense in that world to do a fair bit of color hosing too, because it's a persecution vibe.
Yep.
You know what I mean? You have Dust to Dust, another great example of, you know, negative costing and tapping into sort of a biblical naming convention here to get a certain point across. There's a little bit of that going on with the green black cards too, which we'll talk about in a little bit, I'm sure. But I really appreciate in this set that it's a challenge creatively to execute white based on what has happened in Magic leading up to this point. And they didn't change it a little bit. This is a really radical departure.
It's a sharp change.
Looking at the artwork,
yeah,
and the names,
yep,
of this set, the white cards, it doesn't resemble Magic at all leading up to this point. Look at the art for Tivadar's Crusade. Yeah. That's pretty horrifying.
It's pretty bad.
Yeah.
It's pretty bad.
That's a pretty provocative piece of art.
That's one of the ones where, like, if your mom saw it or whatever, like, back, yeah, in the day, be like, what game are you playing?
Don't worry, it's a goblin.
Yeah.
It's not a person, it's a goblin. Don't worry.
Yeah, but she doesn't know.
Yeah.
I don't know if you could tell that much.
Look at the art for Preacher.
Yeah.
That's another one of, this is not someone who's leading a passive and calm congregation.
That's Bray Wyatt.
This is someone trying to rally the congregation into, let's say, an angry mob.
Yes.
To go do whatever.
Yep.
So the white cards in the set, it gets lost a little bit in sort of a historical analysis because the cards here are so weak. You have Preacher, which is relatively powerful, but not by modern sensibilities. Dust to Dust is not a bad card. It has purpose. But by and large, we're talking about a really lean list of cards. And so it doesn't get the sort of scrutiny analysis that a lot of other sets and colors and sets get, but the creative execution of white and the set, I think, is brilliant.
I've got some traitor / enemy colors working together. Green and black, they teamed up for three cards in this set. Elves of Deep Shadow, Wormwood Tree Folk, and Dark Heart of the Wood. And then blue teamed up with red for... Yeah, go ahead.
Did you put your hand in the fish tank? It's electric eel time.
It sure is.
Got a little bit of go around for everyone.
Now, We're not gonna focus much on the heel because
you got rubber gloves and I don't have rubber. You should get yourself some.
Did they have rubber gloves?
Because it's electric in those waters.
Did they have rubber gloves back then? In the dark?
Probably not.
Yeah, I don't think so. People were getting shocked by that eel. Let's talk about this team up here, excuse me, of green and black cards. I know you're really into kind of the story that's going on here.
It's so good. Okay, so Magic at this time, very much defined by the notion of allied colors and enemy colors. Mm-hmm. The way Magic works nowadays with the way that they produce sets, yeah, on occasion, they do still tap into the, you know, white is allied with green and blue, and that means that they work together and the color hoses are less frequent and they have a cycle of dual lands that you need to them, and the enemy colors don't do that kind of stuff, and they have color hosers target one another and so on. Still a little bit of that going on, but you look at Strixhaven, Ravnica, Khans of Tarkir. These are all sets that just say, yeah, the color pairings or whatever. We're not really doing the allied versus enemy thing anymore. Not so in early Magic.
Yes.
And if you look at Legends, you will notice that every gold card is either a allied pairing, so like a red-green card, let's say, or it is a shard.
Yep.
So it is... You know, Nicol Bolas is a Grixis card. It's black alongside the allied colors of red and blue, and all five of the dragons are oriented that way. There's a color and then the allied colors with it. So, first of all, another great decision in terms of expanding the creative space. How do you indicate that the world is dark, that there's evil afoot, that magic has been corrupted somehow? Well, we're going to take that paradigm and flip it. And now there's enemy colored gold cards. So that's a first, and it does so much to convey the tone of the world. I also want to specifically highlight Dark Heart of the Wood and Elves of Deep Shadow as being such good executions of this the first time around. And I'm sort of blown away looking at these cards in retrospect.
Like, how they kind of
nailed
it.
They're so far ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
So you have an enemy color pairing. You have a world, which is corrupted magic, mystery, you know, forbidden arts, that sort of thing. You have Dark Heart of the Wood, which takes a very green thing, which is gaining life, and it pairs it with an extremely negative and invasive cost of sacrificing your lands. Mm-hmm. So you have this card that reads very green and very black. It makes sense as a gold card, but the story there is very like, what is going on here? Like, yeah, I'm getting life. That's a good thing. But sacking my lands is sort of an interesting, you know, the execution of drawbacks is so much in the Lord of the Pit, Force of Nature space of, yeah, you're getting this big monster demon sort of thing. This is like this pulsating energy of life. Now let's take a look at Elder of the Deep Shadow. Again, tap to make mana. Very simple thing. But it taps for black mana, which is very different and... gives a sense of corruption to the world.
Yep.
How do we get that across? You take 1 point of damage. So simple, but both of those designs are such a good execution of the world here is corrupted. And how can you tell? Well, first of all, we're doing enemy colored stuff in the first place, which is forbidden territory, basically leading up to this point. And then the designs themselves, even Electric Eel, which is kind of funny. It's fire breathing, but you take damage.
Yeah.
There's a sense of, there's like a contrast. There is, you normally get this thing, but you have to pay a different cost. There's an expansion of the color pie in a way that's very novel, but the cards aren't particularly complicated. It's really brilliant stuff. And Elf of D-Shadow is like still beloved in spite of not being particularly powerful relative to a lot of the other elves that are available now, that if you're looking for one ones for that tap for a mana, there's a plethora of options. It's not like this is unique anymore, but there's something so cool about, oh, it taps for a black and you take one.
It's a really well designed.
So good.
It's a really well designed
so
card.
So good.
That tells a story.
When I talk about the stuff with white and the green and black cards, yeah, you, the set is light on, I mean, zero, basically, on new mechanics. And it's not even really taking any of the old stuff. And the cards aren't that powerful in a historical sense.
Sure.
So it's really easy to say there's nothing going on here. But those executions of the green-black cards and the white cards, in terms of you look at them and there's a different emotional experience, I push back on the notion that there's nothing new here. because the way that certain things about the color pie and certain how do we connect green and black together in a way that makes sense. You know, like you could imagine the Dark Heart of the Woods floating in a bayou.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And it's like, okay, well, how do I get access to this thing? Well, you have to sacrifice something.
Yeah. And then it's, oh, bayou. That's the land where the, like you can, it starts, it tells a story without telling a story.
Yeah.
It's a one sentence, simplest text box you can imagine on both of these cases, but really brilliant in terms of opening up. What does it mean to interpret two colors together? What does it mean to do white in a world that's corrupted and evil?
Yeah.
What does it do? What does it mean to do black in a world that's much brighter and lighter? I don't necessarily know if you get to the idea of elves being black in Lorwyn if you don't start here.
Okay.
Because it's like, how do we execute when the world is so either lawful or evil? How do we do the other side of that and the side of the color pie? Really complicated. And this set just knocks it out of the park the first time.
The only other thing I have to note on the cycles here is there's a pair. You've already mentioned one half of it, which is Ashes to Ashes, and then there is Dust to Dust. Both have names related to the Book of Common Prayer, and both are uncommon sorceries with a mana cost of 1 MM that exile 2 permanents of a certain type. So in other episodes of the Resleevables, you know, we've had very lengthy discussions on cycles, top-down, you know, trying to hit all the colors and stuff like Moxen and stuff like that. You only find any of that here in the dark, again, which kind of shows you that, at least in my estimation, that they just decided they wanted to pull back a little bit and just make kind of everything a little bit simpler after such a busy set that Legends was.
What's also interesting about it is contrasting to Arabian Nights and Antiquities, there's... it's a much larger set in terms of new designs.
Mm-hmm.
So that could be the push-pull, right? We're going to ease up a little bit on the new mechanic, all this new stuff to learn. But the trade-off is maybe that gives us more bandwidth to just make more cards because the individual cards are a lot less complicated than they were in all the sets that came before.
That's it for the cycles. When I come back, it's trivia time. We're going to cover just a couple of misprints and then a whole bunch of fun facts about the dark. See you soon. All right, everybody. It is trivia time with some misprints thrown in. Now, sometimes we split these sections into two, but I don't have a lot of misprints for you today in our episode covering the dark. So I'm going to go over these misprints really quick, and then we're going to have some fun with trivia. The misprints that we have here, there's a couple. The artist Dennis Detweiler is incorrectly credited as Denise Detweiler on the following cards: Flood, Goblin Rock Sled, Merfolk Assassin, Pikeman, Scavenger Folk, Squire, and the very powerful Tividar's Crusade. And then there is a functional reprint here in Goblin Hero, which is 2 red for a 2/2 goblin. Gray Ogre from Revised and Raging Bull from Legends are the comps. However, I think you have a term for this.
Well, it's strictly different.
Correct.
Because, yes, it's a goblin, which is generally a positive thing, but not exclusively, because Tividar's Crusade is in this as well.
Yeah.
Strictly different.
Strictly different.
I don't even call it a pet peeve of mine, because it's the type of thing that lets me know I'm never going to struggle to find a job. But the way that people, that players of games say strictly better or strictly worse when they just mean strictly different, It is a recurring joke, let's say, among my industry contemporaries.
I'll just tell you straight up, you've never heard me say those words before.
What, strictly different? Strictly
better.
Oh, strictly better. Oh, yeah.
You've never heard me say
strictly?
That.
Strictly? You sure?
Yeah.
You better be sure. There's a lot of game pieces out there.
Yep.
You sure it's better in all of them?
All situations?
Yeah.
Yeah. Every single one?
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. I do know. That's not true. Trivia. Healthy amount here for you. Not nearly as much as you saw in the Legends episode if you joined us for that, but I've got some here for you. So let's start with the general trivia. Many cards in this set blatantly conflict today's ideas of a color pie, assuming you believe in the idea of a color pie, which we'll be discussing here momentarily. Erosion is blue land destruction. Fire and Brimstone is white direct damage. Fissure is red targeted creature destruction. Holy Light is white toughness reduction. Mana Vortex is blue mass land destruction. Merfolk Assassin offers blue repeatable creature destruction. Mind Bomb is direct is blue direct damage or discard, excuse me. Preacher offers white repeatable creature control. Witch Hunter is both white direct damage and repeatable bounce. And then Word of Binding is black creature tapping. So,
okay, so before we get into it, I'm going to push back on the notion of Merfolk Assassin being repeat creature removal. It only kills things with Island Walk.
There could be a lot of those.
Potentially, and there is a combo in the set. But
yeah, there is.
Is Tap Destroy a Goblin repeat creature destruction? I don't know. It sort of depends on how many goblins the other person has. But whatever.
You can be a little judicious with how that works, I suppose.
So I'll preface all this by saying that different people, different game designers have very different answers for this sort of question.
Yes.
I'm only providing my own sensibilities.
Okay.
I would say that rate matters a lot in this conversation. I would also say that the degree to which the thing is adjacent to something else that the color does is also part of this.
Okay.
So, for example, Erosion. It is a weird blue card. No, I'm not going to argue that. But there's two things going for it. One is that it's extremely weak.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, saying that this is blue land destruction and Boomerang isn't is really weird to me. But this is like getting into the root of it, right? It's like,
yep.
No, the land isn't destroyed, but there's plenty of times where it sure feels like your land was destroyed.
Yep.
And also Boomerang's way stronger than Erosion.
Yes.
So which one of these is more color pie bleeding? Even though bounce is obviously a foundational element of blue's color pie. I don't know. It's complicated, but I think you're supposed to do disperse, not Boomerang, partially for this reason. Some of it's play pattern, some of it's color pie too. A Fissure, another really good example of, yeah, destroy a target creature in red is not a red text box, mm-hmm. and making it an instant definitely exacerbates it because you can look at, you know, Jogle Hops, Obliterate, even Inferno in this set is like pretty close to kill all the creatures. So yes, it is violating the color pie on read, but let's compare Fissure to Unholy Heat or Scred. Sure. Now I know those cards deal damage, but there's a ton of rate in them. They're instants and they deal a ton of damage. Which one in practice violates the color pie more frequently? I don't believe that Terror, 2-mana destroy non-red and non-black creature, and 2-mana instant red card theoretical deal 8 to target creature. You couldn't tell me, well, it's dealing damage. It's like at a certain point, it's an infinity symbol.
Yeah.
We're talking about a terror here.
Yep.
The ones that to me are the bad examples in here, the ones that you're not supposed to do this, in my opinion, they're kind of beyond the pale. Witch Hunter is the best example of it doesn't read at all like a white card. It doesn't play at all like a white card. And it's in low power games or if players have relatively like new collections or whatever, it's reasonably strong.
Yep.
A lot of these other examples are either adjacent, and to follow up on the adjacency point with Erosion, taxing mana is a thing that blue does.
Yeah, yeah.
So even though, yes, taxing lands is not really a blue thing, or destroying lands is not really a blue thing, taxing things is, mm-hmm. and it's super weak. So it doesn't bother me in the same way that Witch Hunter does.
Okay.
But I'm only answering for myself here. If you said, yeah, blue's just not supposed to destroy lands, end of story, I would say, sure, yeah, that's fine. But then I would point to Boomerang and be like, can we make this disperse as quickly as possible? Because a lot of the power from this thing comes from returning someone's land in their hand. And let me tell you, when your opponent Boomerangs you on their second turn going first, sure feels like a stone rain. It might be in your hand. I'm telling you, it feels a lot different.
Well, there's a whole deck built around that.
Yeah, I know. So it's not a zero in competitive play. Yeah. Whereas Erosion is like a zero.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's extremely weak.
It's a really bad card.
Really, really weak. Yeah. Until they bring Devotion for Blue back, I guess. And then it's an Erosion party.
I think Witch Hunter and Word of Binding,
yes,
are the most offensive if you believe in the color pie. And I say believe in the color pie because, like, this is the fourth expansion in Magic. They're still, even though the game is successful, they're still figuring it out. Like, I don't really think that a color pie was really established at this point of like, okay, we definitely can't do these things. Like, Magic as we know it now, you know, when I think of black, for the most part, I think of a color that cannot kill enchantments, even though it sort of can now. And I think of the same thing about it. I think the same thing about red, right? But back then, when the game is still in its infancy, this is our sixth episode of the show because we're covering our sixth set. I don't know, like, maybe they're not sure what they want the restrictions or rules or color pie to be at that point. So they're going to try some stuff and see if it works or doesn't work.
I would say, I guess the shorter answer for kind of to summarize my feelings is for color pie stuff, I triangulate. There's like three pillars that matter to me. How does it read? How does it play? How strong it is.
Okay.
And the more that, you know, like it's violating on multiple axes or it's violating on one extremely loudly, that is more likely to offend my sensibilities.
Okay.
Like look at like Chaos Warp, for example.
That commander red card? Yeah.
That can target enchantments, right?
Pretty sure.
I'm almost positive it can. So
let's take a little look-ski here.
Let's bring up Chaos Warp here.
I'm sure it's on the screen between us.
Yep, but I want to have it in front just to confirm before we dive too deep into this.
All right, so Chaos Warp, the owner of target permanent shuffles it into their library, then reveals the top card of their library. If it's a permanent card, they put it onto the battlefield.
So this certainly reads like a red card,
mm-hmm.
but something that this can effectively do is destroy enchantments.
Yep.
Not only that, in practice, a lot of the rate is nested in the fact that it gives red a way to handle enchantments.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we're talking about the other permanent types, they have creature removal, they have artifact removal, they have land destruction. Really, the only weak spot is enchantment removal.
Yep.
So the fact that it shuffles and it has a random output, the fact that either you can do it to either player, all these things help. But if someone said, yeah, the fact that this is basically blowing up enchantments is a bright line for me, I would say, yeah, I get it. Like that makes sense to me. I don't know that I would fall on that extreme of a line, but that's what I'm talking about of read plus actual experience plus power level.
Sure.
Is how I tease out whether things bother me or not.
Okay. That makes sense. Let's see what else I got here for trivia. There we go. Although the multicolor cards in Legends did not, the three multicolor cards in the dark have reminder text to remind the player that the cards count as two colors. So if you're looking at, let's say, the Elder Dragon cycle from Legends, Chromium, Nicol Bolas, so on and so forth, they don't remind you that they are, you know, those colors. Whereas if you look at the three gold cards from this set, Marsh Goblins, Scarwood Goblins, and Dark Heart of the Wood, they all say counts as both a black card and a red card, or just counts as both of whatever colors they are.
I'm assuming this created some level of confusion when Legends came out, because it's not unreasonable to me to say, like, yeah, I can terror your Nicol Bolas, because it's not a non-black creature. It's a black, red, blue creature.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there is a certain level of legalese going on with that interpretation of the rules. It seems obvious, but if you told me one player out of 10 was confused by it at the time, I wouldn't be surprised at all.
No.
So a little bit of reminder text. I don't think it's worth it if you were doing a million gold cards in the set, but with only three, it's like whatever.
Only one of the four lands printed in the dark produces mana. There are four lands in the set: City of Shadows, Maze of Ith, Safe Haven, and Sorrow's Path, which will be winning an award later in the show. City of Shadows technically taps for mana, but you have to work for it.
Yeah, you go turn one Ornithopter, City of Shadows, send it away, and then you go from there.
Yeah, you're really going off there.
Now you're starting to go off.
Largest power and toughness. Let's discuss those. Leviathan has the greatest combined power toughness among all creatures until Polar Kraken in the Ice Age expansion. It's also the first creature printed with double-digit power and toughness. Do you know how big it is?
It's a 10-10.
That is correct.
So the way that I figure that out is I know that Polar Kraken's 11-11.
Okay.
And you said the power and toughness are both double-digit.
Yeah.
There's only one number that's lower than 11 that's double-digit. Whole number? 10-10.
You genius.
Mathemagician.
Smartest guy I know. Carnivorous Plant has the greatest combined power and toughness among green creatures
good
in the dark.
You trying to attack? Good luck.
It was the first wall without wall in its name, leading many players to think that it could attack. How big is this?
4 or 5. This is another great mechanical space, too, of like, so you, or flavor space, I guess, is probably a better way of putting it. Is, yeah, you have walls. structures they're building in the ground. Mm-hmm. Really easy to buy into that. And it's like, well, what are other things that would be immobile but would not be a built structure?
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, like a Venus flytrap, like a gigantic magical Venus flytrap.
Yeah.
Cool. So love that. Maybe a little bit of confusion, but I think well worth it to expand the creative space of walls are not just walls of stone and walls of ice, but also things that are otherwise immobilized.
This is kind of the fun little thing that I thought of right now, which is, you know, in the infancy of magic and also sometimes nowadays, like, when are you supposed to put reminder text on something and when are you not? One could be just space related, right? Where it's just like, we don't have enough space in the card to put the reminder text. But other times, case in point, in Legends, they didn't feel the need to say that they counted as the different colors, right? Mm-hmm. In this set, they basically have reminder text on the three gold cards that are, oh, right, okay, we didn't have that. It was confusing last time. So we've put that on here that these cards are these colors, right? And now with Carnivorous Plant, it's a wall and it's creature type. Nowadays, it would be a plant in its creature type or something like that. Mm-hmm. And then it would probably say on the card, like maybe it would say, like, I think it would just have keyword defender.
Yeah, it would just
right?
be
just have mechanic defender, right? Yeah. But in this set, it says it's a wall, but then it has like a story that it tells. And so people are probably like, well, I can attack with it because this isn't like the other walls.
Keep in mind, this is also an era where there is just a higher frequency of misprints.
Yeah, that's
so
true.
So it's like not unreasonable to be like, yeah, this is a misprint. Obviously, it's supposed to attack. Now, the way that you would get clued in that this was not supposed to attack was the fact that by the standards of 1994, this thing would be wildly overrated.
A 4-mana 4/5
with no drawback.
Yeah.
Like Ur-Nam-Dijin was a banger.
Yeah.
And that they made something your opponent had unblockable every turn.
sure.
So you sort of figured it out of like they just don't make cards like this.
Yeah.
But there's some confusion for sure.
Diabolic Machine has the greatest combined power of toughness among artifact creatures in the dark. Do you know what it is?
It's a 4/4.
That is correct. Eater of the Dead has the greatest combined power and toughness among black creatures in the dark. Do you know what it is?
3/4?
That is correct.
Okay.
Ball Lightning.
6/1.
Okay.
Stop. Don't waste any one time. 6/1.
Not even gonna finish that sentence. And the Knights of Thorn has the greatest combined power and toughness among white creatures in the dark.
That can't be true.
What?
Is that really true?
Yeah, deuce deuce, baby. Deuce deuce. Biggest and the best.
I'll tell you, there's a curse on the land as far as stats goes. There's a pall.
I do really like the idea that like the majority of the white creatures are just 1/1s because they're just like they're humans.
Yeah.
Right? They're just not particularly tough. But then like a knight is a little bit stronger. So it's a 2/2. And then now that I'm looking at this, I also really enjoy that Squire is a 1/2 because it's like a knight in training, but it's not all the way there yet.
Yeah.
And so I kind of like that. I kind of like that.
Squire, a very controversial reprint in Time Spiral.
Not controversial to me. Love that. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about some color-based trivia. I don't have anything of white for you, so I'm going to jump to blue. Merfolk Assassin combos with War Barge.
How?
Which is...
Well, this one's pretty complicated. We might need to walk through it. Okay, so War Barge gives things Island Walk.
It does.
And Merfolk Assassin kills things with Island Walk. So you put them on the ship. You drive them. You
drive
them
to the ocean.
The middle of the sea. Turns out there was an assassin, you know, hanging on to the underside of the boat. Dump them off. Back to port. Rinse, repeat.
Yeah, it's like the it's like the second Black Panther, Wakanda Forever.
Yeah.
With the fish group. Or whatever. Neymar. Some mariner, yeah. He was hanging on the boat.
Yeah.
Just waiting for people to be delivered.
With a dagger in between his teeth.
That's right.
Just waiting.
I'm going to get you.
Waiting.
Merfolk Assassin has some sweet art.
Oh, yeah.
I will say that. That has some sweet art. And there's a boat in the art. That might just be the War Barge.
Yeah. This is not the most subtle call out between two cards in Magic history.
Yeah. Okay. I'm checking. It's like not exactly the War Barge, but it is a boat. So,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. They don't give it the entire thing away, but they do give most of it away.
Let's also note that Water Worm is the only blue worm in Magic's history. I did a little worm search on Scryfall, and it's true. It's the only one. We're going to dive into black trivia now. Your boy, Frankenstein's Monster,
oh, yeah,
is one of only a few cards named after a literary source. It's also the only card that stipulates three different types of counters that can be put on it, something that's avoided today.
Yeah, especially because it's often the same thing.
Yeah.
Because you just, and as someone who's, you know, played with Frankenstein's monster more than most, I'll let you know, most of the time you just pick a distribution of square stats.
Sure.
And so why have plus two, plus O, and plus O, plus two? Now you're trying to tell a story. You know, I get it, but this is like, I love where their heart is at, but this is a place where a head should have won out over heart.
Yeah, the execution not great on this card. Slightly confusing. I'm also going to note here that Murk Dwellers likely inspired the creation of cards that gain a power bonus when attacking, such as Charging Bandits, Hollow Dogs, and Ravenous Scourge. Nameless Race is the only creature without a creature type. And Ragman is mentioned in the flavor text of Dothy Trapper, mm-hmm. which is a card from Stronghold. Let's go to red. Your actual boy, Ball Lightning. Its artwork is referenced in the artwork of Dwarven Shrine from Odyssey.
Which is very odd.
It's very bad card too, Dwarven Shrine.
The shrines are...
One of them was good, right? Wasn't it? I think Cephalid Shrine was a good one. No? They were all bad? Oh, okay. That was like your heyday.
Yeah.
Okay. Goblin Rock Sled created confusion for having Goblin in its name, but not in its creature type, making it unclear to many at the time how it interacted with other cards in the dark that reference goblins.
Also, keep in mind, we're in typo world. This is, you know, a heuristic that I like to use a lot with pickup basketball or like basketball officiating.
Okay.
Is if you did this in a pickup game, would it start a fight?
Okay,
if so, it should be a foul.
Okay.
If I have Goblin King and I play a Goblin Rock Sled and you're like, that's not a goblin, that's a rock sled, it would start a fight. Like, that's not, it's not okay. It's like, there's goblins in the art.
It's a rock sled.
I don't know. I think it's a...
See, the thing is I'm the person that would tell you it's a rock sled.
Yeah, I think it's an inanimate, like, sort of event.
Yeah.
And not the goblins in the artwork called Goblin Rock Sled. Not acceptable. Unacceptable.
I like the idea of, so the name of the card is Goblin Rocks. Man, I was like, maybe if there's like an apostrophe S, like Goblins Rock Sled, and it's like, clearly it's a rock sled. It's not a goblin.
Yeah.
You know, it's just their sled.
If you couldn't look up Gatherer, that argument would start a physical
back
fight.
Back then.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's a goblin. Yeah. Don't tell me it's not a goblin.
Mm. I don't think it is, though. Inferno inspired the creation of Bloodfire Colossus.
And a million other cards.
Yes. way to blow that up. Mana Clash is the only card with a casting cost of a single red that can potentially win the game on the first turn without any other assistance.
Hmm. Well, the odds are that are quite low.
Someone, you know what? I'm coming to our YouTube audience right now. I'm going to go to my direct cam right here. I want the math in a YouTube comment or tweet or something.
So the math has to be you win, mm-hmm. you specifically win, because part of the range of this card is also you die on the first turn.
Yes, sure.
Most of the time what happens with this is both players take a relatively small amount of damage and then you move on with life.
Yes.
It is technically possible, like fractions of fractions of fractions of fractions of percent, for this to generate a turn one kill.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not that it kills you with the same frequency it kills your opponent.
Very rarely.
Yeah.
It's what I would say.
But yeah, I'm curious to the math.
Yeah, if there's a, you just call it a math magician. Is that what you said earlier?
Yeah, math magician.
Yeah, if there's a math magician watching the show, I'd love to know what insane math is necessary for someone to get killed
by
this.
Well, it's complicated because there's so many permutations of the way that it can kill on turn one.
I know.
It's like, I could just, you lose 20 flips and I don't lose any. I lose one. I lose two. We each lose 19. Then you lose the 20th.
Mm-hmm.
I lose 12 flips. You lose 20. Like, there's just a lot of...
I'm sure that someone knows.
It's not simple math.
No. Not for us. But maybe for you. Also, fun note about Mana Clash. The card is named after one of a few names considered for a time for the title of the game of Magic, which was considered too common a word to trademark. So, as a result, Magic had to add, of course, colon, the Gathering... to make it unique. So in an alternate universe, we could be playing and doing videos about Mana Clash, not Magic the Gathering. That's a thing that could have potentially happened.
Magic is a much better name.
We agree. Let's go to green. Gaia's Touch was initially misprinted with all of its text, expansion symbol, and mana cost shifted to the left, which you'll probably see right around these parts, the shifted version and then the non-shifted version. Marsh Viper is the only creature in this expansion with the poison mechanic. They decided to bring it back and dabble again. Venom gave the ability of Thicket Basilisk, Cockatrice, and Infernal Medusa a name to be referred by. And then a real problem causer here is Whippoorwill.
Mm-hmm.
Along with Frozen Shade and Blinking Spirit, confused many players by depicting a creature apparently in mid-flight in its art without actually having flying. This kind of disparity between the art now and ability is this. You don't see this happen in Magic anymore. Something looks like it's flying. It has flying. Whippoorwill is a bird, and it's clearly flying in the picture, but it does not have flying. And as you said, and I think this is actually more salient now than it was previously to me, you were living in a world where, like, there were mistakes.
Yeah.
So you could just go like, oh, they forgot to put flying on there.
It's a bird.
Yeah.
It's flying in the art.
Yeah.
This thing is, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, and someone's
well,
just
you just said, well, the last game we played, you said that McGobbin Rock Slide wasn't a goblin, so I don't see flying on that thing. I think your Whippoorwill is on the ground. I'll block
that.
Yeah. I'll block with my Gray Ogre.
Yeah.
Put it in the graveyard. Or we could have some good common sense rules around, yes, your Whippoorwill flies, and yes, my Goblin Rock Slide is a goblin.
Yeah, I like the idea of just, like, you know, playing at home with your friends, and it's just like, yeah, Whippoorwill has flying, and the Rock Slide's obviously a goblin.
Yeah.
Right? Just make your own rules.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
It's not like anyone knew the rules.
No.
Right. No. So, and at least if there's sort of, like, a story, at least, that's better than playing incorrectly and also allowing those flavor fails to infest your game.
Yeah, I'm all for it. Colorless trivia. City of Shadows inspired the creation of Altar of Shadows. Cole Gullum, your boy,
mm-hmm.
Has an ability that allows any deck to cast Ball Lightning.
Oh, yeah. Or Meiji Dijin or Yidwin Ifrit, other triple red bangers from the era.
I was also surprised at the fact that you knew this, is that Cole Gullum inspired the creation of the Attendant Cycle in Evasion.
Oh, yeah. Well, you have to remember that you never know this sort of thing for sure.
Okay.
But I would be willing to bet that I have thought about Cole Gollum more than any human being in recorded history. And so anything that's Cole Gollum adjacent, I'm like, oh yeah, that's Cole
that's
Gollum.
That's a callback.
That's on Cole Gollum's family tree right there. Yeah, they made five of them. They were actually kind of useful cards, at least in draft, because fixing your mana like that is way more useful than just here's all the red mana in the world.
Sure, sure.
But they don't go that well very often.
These attendants in Invasion allowed you to cast the corresponding legendary dragons from the legendary cycle in the set. I can't wait till we get to Invasion, by the way. Maze of Ith was restricted in Vintage from October 1994 until April 1999. That's a long time. For its ability to slow games down significantly, this card was heavily played was Maze of Ith due to its power level, and under old Mulligan rules resulted in many opening hands without mana sources. Now, I think the old Mulligan rules, like, if you didn't have any lands untapped for mana, you just got to throw your hand back?
No, it was like it was something like one land, six lands.
Okay.
Or zero land, seven lands. You could mulligan and everything else you had to keep.
Okay, okay.
So you could draw up, like, double maze, not be able to mulligan. And
oh, that's interesting.
I might be bungling that a little bit, but it was something along those lines.
Let us know in the comments. Easy breezy.
No, don't, because okay. People are just like, oh, they confused this, like, wrinkle in the rules from 1994. It's like, sorry.
All right, don't ever comment.
I only know nearly everything, not actually everything. Apologies.
Reflecting Mirror is the first card to have the ability to change the target of another spell.
Mm-hmm.
Safe Haven has an ability that originally functioned at interrupt speed, like Red Elemental Blast, because there were a few cards at the time that could kill a creature at interrupt speed. Apparently, this card also inspired the creation of Cold Storage. Sure.
Cool.
And then Sorrow's Path. Let's talk about it. It is voted to be, quote, the worst Magic card in terms of power ever made, quote, says Mark Rosewater. I heard from a little birdie, maybe it was a Whippoorwill, though it didn't fly here, that you may disagree.
Oh, yeah. Rosewater is very wrong. We'll get into it here. So it really does reveal something very interesting about negative costing. So to begin with, Sorrow's Path is quite weak. I'm not saying this is like a playable card by any stretch of the imagination,
mm-hmm.
but I would argue Sorrow's Path is significantly stronger than the bans with other Legends lands from Legends in the previous set. There's probably some other examples as well. And it's the fact that the card pays 2 life when you activate it. You're like, okay, so it doesn't tap for mana and it costs 2 life and it's not even that good.
Yep.
Well, obviously that's the worst card. Not an unreasonable place to get to, but there are, if you played 1,000 games with just like random cards, like every game you and your friend, it's just, here's a totally random collection of cards. Go repeat, repeat, repeat.
Okay.
I would wager that 1 game out of 1,000 Sorrow's Path would be like at least a little bit useful.
Okay. But
there'd be a spot where it's, oh, it's kind of annoying they actually have that right now. Whereas the bans with other Legends lands and Wood Elemental, like they never have a spot like that.
Wood Elemental is especially heinous.
Really, yeah. Really bad. So yes, it is weak, but I think part of the reaction to this is the worst card of all time. And to be clear, when I was a player, that was the sentiment. Of just,
yes.
Like, yeah. This card's a joke. It's the worst card in the game. No, it's not. It's just the negative costing of it combined with the fact that it is actually quite weak is what causes that perception.
Okay.
If I get a Sorrow's Path and you get an Adventurer's Guild House, you are in trouble. Guarantee it. You're in trouble.
Well, deal with that. Multicolor trivia here really quickly. Dark Heart of the Wood is the first multicolored non-creature card and the first enemy color pair card, which I mentioned earlier. And cards for the other 4 enemy color pairs were not printed until Mirage. So we don't see any Boros, Simic.
Is it?
And Orzhov cards until Mirage. And then also Marsh Goblins and Scarwood Goblins are the first non-legendary multicolored creatures. And let me back up because I forgot one minor thing in the colors area. Stone Calendar. Inspired the creation of the Medallion Cycle in Tempest, which further inspired the Familiar Cycle in Planeshift and the War Chief Cycle in Scourge.
Yeah, I mean, this is another example of, yeah, these designs were inspired by, which means these are all super cracked versions of the first one.
That's correct.
Like, it's actually pretty interesting. Familiars, Medallions, and War Chiefs, that's like, that collection of cards really overrepresented and constructed for a random collection of 15 or 20 cards.
Yeah, they're
it's
really
like a
good.
Lot there.
Those are really good cards.
But it's a really appealing thing to do. Players love it. And it's also an interesting thing to think about because it's like, oh, why would I care about this versus just having something that makes 1 mana? It's like, oh, what if you're playing 2 cards in a turn? Oh, well, what does it mean to play 2 cards in a turn? And why would I want to do that specifically? And now the wheels are turning.
Sure.
I'm sort of starting to think about, well, what are the cards that are really good if I'm playing multiple cards in a turn, or what can that incentivize? What can that facilitate in a way where you don't even need to engage with it on that level? Because if you're just like, yeah, my cards are 1 less, that they work that way just fine too.
Yep. So
cool cards.
All right, everybody. Trivia misprints done, which means it's time for some fun. Award show coming up right after this short break. All right, everybody, it is now time for your favorite part of the show, my favorite part of the show, everybody's favorite part of the show. It's the award show for The Dark. As always, we are starting with the Oko Thief of Crowns Award for the best card in the set, and I'm going over to you, partner. You may begin.
There's a lot of, you know, as usual, a lot of ways to approach this question. I'm going to give it to Blood Moon.
Ooh.
It's still a feature of Modern and Legacy. And at the time, it was an extremely impactful card kind of day one, because one of the ways that how does a difference in collection or experience manifest? It's you own all the revised duels and I don't. That back in the day was a much more common thing. And Blood Moon really leveled the playing field. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is like Gloom or Karma, but for the person playing with nothing but non-basic lands, that's where a lot of Magic's power level rests of the time between the dual lands, Strip Mine, Mistress Factory, Library of Alexandria. So this card was awesome in terms of just impact at the time and continues to show up in high powered formats.
Yeah. And for me, as you're going to find out here, this may be a bit of a trend. I also have Blood Moon as my winner of the Oko Thief of Crowns Award for basically every single thing that Patrick did say. And because I know this comes up sometimes where You find folks who watch these videos feel like sometimes we forget to mention some cards. That's our first mention of Blood Moon, and it won maybe the best award. So there you go. Carnival of Souls award for worst card in the set. We have the same answer.
Is it the carnival?
The carnival is the award.
Oh, excuse me. That's Sorrow's okay. Path.
Correct. There you go. Let's go to the Doomblade award for best non-rare in the set. We have the same answer. It is Maze of Ith. Just a really good card.
Yeah.
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 Doesn't tap for mana, but doesn't need to.
Yeah. It still has a little bit of legacy sign to it in land strategies. And
I wonder if that's still a deck.
I would imagine it's also a pretty useful card in Commander to some extent, because it's one of those, one, don't attack me, and two, you can negotiate with me because I can provide some utility in your combat exchanges.
Okay.
But I also don't know for sure, nor do I care.
Good answer. Boro Palace of the Clouds award for fun of one of in the set. My answer is Tormod's Crypt, as it's a card that you can find off of Urza's Saga. You can like Enlightened Tutor for. If you're going to play some Graveyard Hate in your sideboard, you generally don't want like a bunch of these. You kind of want to mix it up so it feels like a one of to me. So that's why that's my answer. Yours is?
Dark Heart of the Wood.
Bang.
So cool. And also, it was actually a card that kind of on the local level showed up a little bit here and there. And anytime anyone had it, I was like, that is so cool.
We're going to go on to our Mystic Confluence Award.
But you don't want to play a lot of them.
That's true. For best vintage cube card in the set, we have the same answer once again. This was a bit of a struggle because this set isn't particularly powerful. My answer and Patrick's answer was Elves of Deep Shadow, pardon me, which I think you said very well in our pre-show meeting is like the ninth best mana elf or whatever.
Yeah, but it's so cool that no one cares.
Yeah, like it's not even in the vintage cube nowadays. The only other card I could really find that maybe would win this award is Maze of Ith, which is also, I believe, not in the vintage cube anymore either. So that kind of just goes to show you the power level of the dark or lack thereof. Smothering Tide Award for best commander card in the set.
Felwar Stone.
Mm-hmm.
Which I actually appreciate a lot as a commander card. Because mm-hmm. a lot of the way that the commander cards get over is, well, for each opponent, do one more thing. And yeah, unsurprisingly, that stuff scales when there's three opponents rather than one. Felwar Stone also scales in a way, but it's more reliable or more flexible the more players in the game. That's a sweet way to scale up.
Yep.
So I love that this was an old card, wasn't really made with multiplayer necessarily in mind, but it has some added context in Commander that's really fun. And I've started playing Commander with some friends who have some relatively low power decks, and Felwar Stone is a staple of our games.
My answer was also Felwar Stone. We have the same answer. We're going to go to the Pack Red Award for best limited card in this set. Now, we had the same answer initially. Then this guy maybe found a little something here. So my answer and his initial answer was Preacher. Seems pretty good to just take their best thing and try to kill
them. Is there any removal in this set?
You know what?
I'm not sure there's any removal in this set.
Okay.
Witch Hunter?
That is sort of removal.
Merfolk Assassin.
So Witch Hunter deals damage to a player and then it can bounce their thing.
Okay.
Okay, so that Tivit Arch Crusade.
Okay.
So, hang on. Ashes to Ashes.
Ashes to Ashes.
Okay. That counts. I'm basically looking in black and red now. Marsh Gas is just power. That's not it. Got a little ahead of myself there. I'm sure someone's screaming at home saying, this is removal. Brothers of Fire just goes, deals one damage to any target.
Okay.
Okay, so that sort of counts. Like, if you're Fissure.
Yeah.
Fissure, that's a premium.
Oh, yeah.
Premium selection in a booster draft. Inferno,
mm-hmm.
I would not pass that card. To answer your question, there's not much.
Okay.
There's
so
not much.
So Preacher's a fine choice if you were to draft the Dark by itself.
But you found something maybe a little better.
I want to give a shout out to Flood. One of the first limited bombs that didn't have a constructed pedigree behind it. This manifested one of the very first Pro Tours where there was a format, I can't remember if it was 4th Visions or 5th Edition Visions, but it was like Core Set plus Visions was the draft format.
Okay.
Don't ask me, I wasn't qualified. I wasn't really paying attention competitively at this point. And you have, like, booster drafts kind of a thing at this point. There's pockets of it where certain teams are drafting a lot, but for a lot of the players that are showing up the Pro Tour, there wasn't a limited scene where they were, and they didn't get to practice. Most of the best cards in a random booster draft format have at least some level of constructed consideration. Like, yeah, Icy Manipulator. That's a card that shows up every now and again. So I would imagine it's good in draft. Sarah Angel, much the same deal.
Mm-hmm.
Flood was the first one where there's really no constructed pedigree to it, and it is game over. It's over. What are you supposed to do? It's so hard back then to attack that if your opponent played 43 cards, like slightly more than the maximum, Floods and Islands, like that could be good enough to beat someone. You can obviously do better than that by just playing with flying creatures and just whatever, sure. But a lot of decks just couldn't beat a Flood. And so this was the first limited bomb that showed up kind of in a professional level setting that did not have a constructed pedigree behind it, and therefore players who didn't draft had no idea what was going on until this happened to them.
Until they got flooded.
They were flooded.
Yeah, he only takes once.
Yeah.
You learn the hard way.
Pick it up and read it, and you're like, oh, it's like you can activate this multiple times a turn, and you can activate it as an instant. I'm looking at my hand. My best card is Hill Giant.
Maybe
I think this is going to be tough.
Can you activate it as an interrupt?
No, because I don't think there's any interrupt speed untapping.
Okay.
Just Twiddle.
I don't know.
I think it's
I don't know the interrupt rules. All right, Chart Rumbler Award for the weirdest card in the set. Your answer, whole Frankenstein.
Frankenstein's monster, pretty weird. Setting aside the +2/+0/+1/+1/+0/+2 counter thing, that's arguably the second weirdest thing about this card. It's also very weird that the casting cost is black X.
Okay.
And then you have to fulfill the requirement of X or else it dies when it comes into play.
Yeah, so as Frankenstein's monster enters the battlefield, exile X creature cards from your graveyard. If you can't put Frankenstein's monster into its owner's graveyard instead of onto the battlefield.
So there's arguably some counterplay. If your opponent has a Tormod script or a Scavenging Ooze, it could affect if you could do it for enough or whatever.
Okay.
But the baseline experience of this card is just casting it for all of your mana, because that's what you're trying to do with X spells. And then your opponent being like, yeah, it's dead. You don't have enough stuff in your graveyard. Really, really weird. And then if you get through all that, then we're in +2/+0/+1/+1/+0/+2 counterland.
I like the idea of just something like, you know, when you're playing a game, it's like, give me dice. It's like, do you have any +2/+0 counters? Do you have any +0/+0? Is anyone? How am I going to do this? I don't know.
Right.
Yeah, I have no idea.
It's a 5/5. A 5/5. Don't bother. And it's really complicated too, because if it's all just 1+1/+1 counters and the card just is what it is, the range of stats you can make with this thing.
Oh yeah.
Like if it's got 5 counters, it's like, well, it could be a 0/10 or a 9/1 or anything in between that. How do you want to break up those points? It's like pretty complicated.
My selection here is Scarecrow, which is a heinous artifact creature that is probably on your screen right now. 5 mana, 2/2, so not the best of statistics. 6 mana and tap it. Until end of turn, all damage done to you by flying creatures is reduced to 0.
You know,
it's a lot of work.
I don't know. Is it that much work? You know what? This card's a lock with Moat. It's like, where are you going to go now?
You know where they're going to
go?
They're going to go to the millstone.
Where are you going
to
go?
They're going to go straight to the millstone.
Tell me, where are you going to go? Where are you going? The ground, that's done. And the sky,
upstairs,
also done.
Scarecrowed it. Yeah, I just need to keep 6 mana up every turn.
Well,
to activate the Scarecrow.
Well, what are they? If your opponent can only cast creatures, yeah.
But sure, what's six mana?
Not what's any amount of mana?
Yeah, sure.
It's there. Scarecrow you.
Blank award for the best card name in the set. My answer is Diabolic Machine. I think that's just, first of all, I like the artwork. I like the idea of a human trying to get through whatever the hell this machine is in the dark. There's just some random machine in when the sun has been blotted out that's attacking and killing people. And it's rather diabolic, apparently. So that is my answer. Your answer is a better one, though.
I love Tormod's Crypt. I think the name is cool regardless. But again, in terms of setting up just a sense of the world and the vibes, Magic at this point has a pretty lengthy history of character names object.
Mm-hmm.
So you have Mistress War Machine, Urza's Avenger, Mishra's factory, Mishra's workshop, blah, 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 all down the line. There's a ton of examples of this. And something about those cards is it sort of conveys present tense. Like this is the Urza's Avenger. And sort of implicit in the present tense is, yeah, and Urza's alive, obviously, because it's Urza's Avenger. It's Mishra's factory. How could they own the thing unless they were still here?
Yep.
Tormod's Crypt is tapping into that same naming convention, Artificer / Planeswalkers, blah. But it's a crypt, which is like kind of like a twist at the end. It's like, oh, Tormod's dead.
Oh, yeah, extremely dead.
So to tap into the naming convention of just, yeah, this is this Artificer's object, this is that Artificer's object, and to basically have a punchline at the end of revealing information inside of that naming convention, awesome. So cool.
I think that's our last one. Let me make sure real quick ski here. It is the John of Avon Award for the best land artwork in the set. My answer is Safe Haven. Just a little lair for someone to run into in the dark, which it might be safe, it might not be. There's a light emanating from it. What's in there? Who knows? But we believe it to be a safe place to go. Yours is the very powerful and good-looking City of Shadows.
Is it just one of the first pieces of art where I was like, I gotta own that card. No. So it just looks so cool.
It does look really cool. Sorrow's Path and Maze of Ith were the other options. I don't even know what's going on in Maze of Ith, if I'm being honest.
It's someone's trapped in the maze. Are you they? Can see it sort of almost looks like a cocoon, but there's a...
Oh.
Yeah. Pretty gruesome, right?
I never really realized this when I used to play with it. Yeah, I don't like looking at that.
Yeah. There's a reason that like the judge and new arts are like a sort of three-quarter shot overhead of
a maze
of a like a hedge maze looking, yeah, Minotaur's maze looking thing.
Okay, yeah, I prefer that, which I'm looking at like the I think I'm looking at I don't know, Judge Fromo or something from the vaults or something. Okay, yeah, I prefer that. Thank you. As far as our Tarmogoyf Award for most underhyped card during previous season and our Aurelius Fury Award for most overhyped card during previous season, we do not have that here for you this week for the dark, but it looks like coming soon.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're almost getting there to have them. So that means we've got one thing left to do. Let's close this baby down here with the dark. What card won the set?
I would give my award to Ball Lightning.
Okay.
It is, I mean, it's just, it looks so awesome. The art, how saturated it is with red, the three red mana symbols. Like, there's a reason that this one just sort of stood out, had some heft behind it. It also plays extremely well and has been the inspiration for dozens of designs down, you know, the Ball Lightning family tree, whatever you want to call it.
Groundbreaker.
Yeah. Blistering Lame. Fire Cat.
Nihilus. Skizik.
Skiznak with the kickbacks.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of them. And it plays really well. It's also, I think, again, tapping into sort of the sense of the world of there's this bit of elemental magic that you're barely able to control, and then it goes away on its own, like either dissipates or the magic behind it is not stable enough. Like, you can tell a story there about it's not just mechanics. There's a real vibe to the card. And then it also is different in a way that is interesting.
Okay.
Because it's very easy to look at the card and be like, okay, well, it's like a fireball kind of.
Sure.
But except you're capped on the amount of mana that you can spend, but you get a better deal up front. Okay, cool. But then you discover all this stuff where it's different. Like, oh, my opponent had a lightning bolt, and so it didn't do anything. Part of what's cool about burn cards is they're not interactive, and my opponent had some interaction for this thing. Okay, lesson learned. There's also the cool moment of, all right, well, you have a Mahamoni back to block, and you're 10. Play Ball Lightning, attack you. And now, do you want to risk sacrifice your Mahamoni, or you want to go down to 4? It's like an interesting, like, there's a lot of, you know, stress and significance on that kind of decision.
Mm-hmm.
And that is also something that plays very differently than a lot of the burn cards, because the burn spells, again, lean into non-interactiveness. And Ball Lightning has moments of like, yeah, you can block, you can lose something and suck some of this up.
If you want to.
And I'm the one with Ball Lightning being like, well, there's no bad answers here. Either your mono mode is dead or you go to four, I'm kind of happy. However, and while that's going on, I'm enjoying watching you stress out, like pick up your modi and put it back down, pick up your modi and put it back down. So card's awesome. Makes a lot of sense in the set. Inspired a million designs. Plays well. Has a tournament resume to it. Was, you know, it's been basically outclassed at this point, but certainly had its time in the sun at the Pro Tour and PTQ Grand Prix level. Yep. So a lot of love for Ball Lightning.
My answer was also Ball Lightning as far as the card that won the set for a lot of the reasons that Patrick said. But the biggest one for me is the gameplay aspect of it. The flavor and the story is all very cool, of course, but I really enjoy the Ball Lightning Blistering Fire Cat experience of I'm doing this. Well, okay, there's my side of playing with it, which is just like I'm doing this and I'm attacking you. You decide what's going to happen. I don't care. Mm-hmm. You know, like now, obviously there is a best case scenario, but also like it's kind of like a weird most scenarios I'm fine with. Right, which is really cool. And then on the other side of things, I like the gameplay experience of playing against it, which is just like, damn it, I have to make a decision now. Like, I don't want to throw away my blocker or, you know, soak up some damage for a thing that's going to just go away, that sort of thing. Or when you see your opponent just tapping three red mana on turn three and you're like, please, no, just not anything but this six damage. I don't really want to deal with this right now. And it's like, nah, it's just, you know, you go from like 16 to 10. You're like, that's a really, it's a good shot.
So
a lot of damage.
It's inspired a lot of designs. You brought up Skizik and the obvious, you know, the dies at end of turn haste story.
Yep.
But I would argue also Ball Lightning is the inspiration for designs like Browbeat and Vexing Devil.
Yeah, the whole, Punisher cards.
The whole vibe of the Punisher experience kind of starts here.
Yeah.
Of you can respond to this in a couple of different ways, but I'm happy with the outcome no matter what.
Yeah, you do whatever you want.
Ball Lightning is the first card to really tap into that emotional experience.
Yeah. So now we're going to give this set a grade. And I'm going to be the negative Nancy here, everybody. So we're going to kick things off with a negative, and then Patrick will bring a little bit more positivity to it. I'm giving The Dark, my lowest grade yet on the show, a 3 out of 10. And here's why. The cards suck. They're just not particularly good cards. There's Blood Moon, which invalidates non-basic lands and is, in a weird way, I imagine its existence, is probably just to keep the people who had all the dual lands in check. And Maze of Ith and stuff like that. But if you take away Blood Moon and you take away Ball Lightning, we're looking at a set that just really is lacking in power level. There's Maze of Ith too, I guess. But, you know, like a set that just really doesn't have any powerful cards. There's no new mechanics. There's no cycles. The flavor of the set is cool. But like as someone who was, and obviously I wasn't playing Magic at the time. But if I was playing Magic at the time, it's like, hey, a new set's coming out. I bet there's some good cards in there. Surprise, there's not. That's not great. So sure. I'm giving it a 3 because I'm not giving it like less than a 3 because I do think the flavor and the story they're trying to tell is really cool. And I do think that your point, which is a very good one, which is the establishment of the further establishment of multicolored cards like Dark Heart of the Wood, that's a huge step forward. And the biggest thing that stood out to me while doing this episode was the story they told Elves of Deep Shadow, which is not a multicolored card, but
yeah, effectively,
but it is a multicolored card. So I think that's a really cool thing they did. But other than the flavor stuff, not very good.
Yeah. So I'm sympathetic too. So my grade for The Dark is a 6,
okay,
which is not my lowest grade so far in the history of the show. My lowest grade has gone to Legends.
That's correct.
I'm sympathetic to everything that you said.
Okay.
And it's not just that the cards are weak. It's a lot of the cards are like boring, unappealing, not much to think about.
Yes.
They're not even aspirational, really. They're just kind of like below rate stuff. That's not good. I'll give you my defense of The Dark, or things that I like about it, at least.
Okay.
I'm a big believer in first do no harm. And this is the first set that basically has no ruinous long-term cards in it.
Okay.
Nothing in the set. I mean, Maze of Ith, at the time, I think it was appropriate to restrict, but Maze of Ith really wasn't the root of the problem. The root of the problem was attacking was just too hard to do.
The creatures all
and
suck.
The creatures were all sucked, and the removal was all busted.
Yeah.
So it was sort of more of the same, not really Maze of Ith's fault. But how many cards in the set would you be reticent to put into a standard format? It's like Maze of Ith, I could see arguing, Maze of Ith plus Planeswalkers is not a thing we would really want going on.
It's a big cost, though, to play Maze of Ith.
Yeah, maybe it's okay.
Doesn't tap for mana.
I think Felwarstone is pretty clearly above rate in terms of, you just two mana comes into play untapped. Mana Rock, the Task for a Colorless, would be out of bounds, and Felwarstone's a lot better than that.
Yep.
So, sure, can't do that. But by and large, we're certainly not talking about Strip Mine and Library of Alexandria and the Power Nine.
No.
It is the first set that's kind of at a sustainable power level. I think the stuff with the color pie, the expansion of the vibe and tone of the color pie is brilliant. Turning white into a lawful evil color and having green have some sort of haunted vibe to it or corrupted vibe is a gigantic step forward. And it doesn't even read that way because the designs are so subtle. Okay. They're not in your face about it, but between the art, the name, and the text boxes, it really comes across. The best cards in the set are actually kind of fun.
Okay. Like
ball lighting's fun. Maze of Ith, maybe not
Maze,
so much,
Maze
but
is not fun.
The next tier down from there is like a pretty fun collection of cards. Felwarstone and a handful of others on top of ball lighting. It's like, actually, it's not another Void, the Abyss, Mana Drain, Caracas, I'll tell you that much.
Sure. Caracas.
The last thing that I would offer, and it's a combination of the First You Know Harm and the color pie stuff, the world feeling very rich and evocative for what it is long-term, most cards don't get played.
Okay.
When a set comes out, everyone's talking about the mechanics, the new stuff. Most of the stuff kind of just over time will fall by the wayside.
Okay.
That is the nature of it. You put out a bunch of sets and not everything is going to hit in tier one competitive. Not everything is going to be a stable of command here. And all that architecture kind of goes away because people stop experiencing the set as the set, but just random individual cards they maybe encounter here and there.
Sure.
And I believe that if you picked up a stack of cards from the dark and just looked through them, you would have more fun doing that than picking up a stack of the average set, including sets that are made recently.
Okay.
And that's how most sets long-term exist.
Okay.
As stacks of cards at your LGS that people just sort of go through,
they just leaf through
and
the
read.
Box. Yeah, sure.
And the dark is actually pretty fun to read the cards that are in here.
Okay.
And the art's cool. The names are cool. Like I said, the vibe, the energy to it, it's different without being dissonant. And long term, you can't ask for a whole lot more out of a set than that. Because the sets that actually do punch above their weight, it's like, that's not good either. It's like, oh, yeah. Yeah, Phyrexian Mana. Yep, we know that one. We play with that one. We ban a bunch of them.
Yeah.
It's sure. actually not bad in the historical analysis to land in a place like the Dark has, where.
Okay.
There's a couple cards you consider. There's a lot of cards that are fun to read and look at, and that's all it is.
Yeah, okay. That's fair. We got a new feature here for you in the show before we do close it down, which is our scoreboard, in which we're going to end every episode, and you can see what we've given grades for our sets. So for Alpha Beta Unlimited, I gave a 10, you gave a 10. For Arabian Nights, I gave a 7, you gave a 9. For Antiquities, I gave a 5, you gave a 6. For Revised, I gave a 7, you gave a 9. And for Legends, you gave a 6 and I gave a 5.
I think you have that reversed.
For Legends,
I gave it a 5.
Yeah.
You gave it a 6.
Yeah, I gave it a 6, you gave it a 5.
Yeah.
And then for The Dark, my lowest grade here, I gave it a 3 and Patrick gave it a 6. So at the end of every episode, we're going to update our scoreboard and present it for you to take a look at. And also, if you do want to go check out any of the previous episodes in which you want to learn why we gave the sets the grades that we did, perhaps this prompts you to do so. With that, we prepare for our exit, but also a preview of what's to come. Homerids.
Thalids. Citizens.
Can I reach it?
Oh, yeah, I think you can get to it.
I got it. I'm going to hit myself in the head, probably.
Spawn tokens.
You want to explain what this is?
Sealed box of the Fallen Empires. Got this thing, I think about 10 years ago from Star City Games. It was on sale, and then they gave me an even better deal on it because the box was busted up. They didn't really know. I don't know if you can tell the corner. I don't care. I just like to look at it. But, yeah, we're going to be going into Fallen Empires next week.
This box, you can't tell at home, really. First of all, the dent is real, if you can see it. Second of all, dusty. Not even, I mean, maybe someone tried to work into it a little bit here.
No, that's how they were sealed up.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just the regular.
This thing has not attempted to be opened and will not be opened.
Retail, $145. It's
Woo!
Funny.
Woo!
$145 a pack. It's funny because, obviously, nowadays, these are worth significantly more than $1.45 a pack.
Yeah.
But at the time, you could not get $1.45. You were 99 cents if you were lucky.
They stores couldn't sell these things?
Oh, we'll talk about that. There's a whole story about Fallen Empires here, and it almost... I mean, this Fallen Empires is probably the first, like, if you've ever talked about the demise of Magic, did Magic almost die? This set is, like, step one to one of the closer times.
Okay, okay. Well, I'm looking forward to having that conversation. I'm also looking forward to you subscribing to our YouTube page here at youtube.com/theresleevables. You can like, you can ring the bell, you can subscribe. I probably got that wrong, but you know what I'm talking about. So we can defeat the YouTube algorithm and get more views and more blah, blah, blahs. If you're not already a patron on our Patreon at patreon.com/theresleevables, we'd love for you to go hang out there as well, where you can get episodes of The Resleevables early before they release to the public on our YouTube page, and also access to our podcast Unsleeved that we record 3 times a month, and some fun goodies like a Resleevable sticker, a signed basic Plains and or Mountain from Patrick and myself, and also a Resleevables playmat. And for our $10 and $25 tier on Patreon, you will be able to be put into our drawing every time we do a crack-a-pack for a new set, which we'll be doing with the Dark, assuming we can get some boosties to do so. Fallen Empires is up next, everybody. We hope you enjoyed our review of the Dark, and we'll see you for all of those Homerids and Thalids very soon.